here driving along in an LT4 8-speed JK. We're going to take a few test drives in this JK. It has so much stuff in it, and I'm not just talking about the powertrain. Of course, it's got the supercharged LT4 8-speed, but it's just got all sorts of accessories, radios, campers. We got Dynatrac 72-inch wide axles and air systems and aftermarket radios. So we're going to do a couple of test drives to ring this thing out. I think the first thing you're going to notice about the LT4, and in my opinion, the LT4 is somewhat of an underrated engine because it's just so docile. I was bombing along yesterday and a Hellcat Challenger flew by me, and it sounded like something right off a drag race track, something that Garlitz would be driving. It was so loud, it was so obnoxious, it was lime green, and it was just drawing a lot of attention to itself. This LT4 is completely the opposite. While having similar horsepower to that Hellcat, it's just so docile that you wouldn't know the other side of the engine, the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. What it boils down to in a Jeep like this is, he can move this thing easily. A little bit of throttle, and all this weight moves. You can hear a little teeny bit of blower whine there, but you can go from 40 to 50 to 60 by barely touching the throttle. If you were in a Penstar JK, you'd mash the throttle, it would rev up to 4,000 or 5,000 RPM, and you still wouldn't accelerate as fast as this LT4. So I guess you can say one of the strengths of the LT4 is just how docile it is. I had a customer when I was doing general automotive repair. His name was Cecil, and he had a Cadillac CTS-V with an LSA in it. And Cecil was 88 years old, and he was an old hot rodder. So while he drove it like an old man, every once in a while he had fun with it. And that's kind of like what this LT4 is. See, the flip side is you can make power in a lot of ways. You can put a camshaft in, you can put headers and an exhaust system in. A camshaft's obviously going to make the engine more radical. The idle's going to be more rumpity rump rump. You put an aggressive exhaust with headers in it, you're going to hear that. You're not going to hear it with the LT4. The LT4 is a grocery getter, and it's pushing 700 horsepower. Along with performance mods like cams and exhaust and raising the compression and all that, is technology. The Europeans and Asians have been big on technology for a long time. Going to four valves, overhead cams, dual cams, all make more horsepower. If we look at the V6 Penstar engine, being a four cam engine with variable valve timing, it's actually a very advanced engine. Chrysler is building them by the millions, and they are somewhat of an economy engine in my opinion, just like the Chevrolet 3.6, where they eliminate the exhaust manifolds, they make a lot of stuff out of plastic. And unfortunately, that's just how engines are going today. I remember back in the days when everything was steel, intake manifolds were iron or aluminum. It just seemed more appropriate for an engine. But with today's technology and polymers, we can make these engines lighter and still remain reliable. Now, I think a lot of these newer engines are throwaway, to tell you the truth. I think when they get 100 and 150,000 miles on them, they're not worth rebuilding. You get plastic that's starting to come apart and warp. So warping a head and blowing a head gasket is not that uncommon. In fact, the JL that Motec bought new with less than 600 miles on it already had a blown head gasket. The vehicle that we're in had a blown head gasket. The customer did put a supercharger on to try to get a little more performance, and within 1,000 miles, he blew a head gasket. Now, if you compare that to an old small block Chevy, flathead, Ford, whatever, those engines were iron, they were solid, and today you can tear one of those engines down, machine it, and put it right back on the road. I don't think modern engines lend themselves to rebuilding like they did in the old days. But with the efficiencies of modern manufacturing, the flip side is we get some really advanced engines with a lot of horsepower, excellent drivability, at an incredibly low price. The LT1s now are in the $7,000 range, and if you consider what you're getting for that money, it's amazing. You gotta be careful with the LT4. I'm cruising along here, the speed limit's 50, and I find myself having to constantly back off the throttle to hold the speed limit because it just wants to go. And there's no drama to it, meaning it's not downshifting, it's not revving up, it just wants to move the weight of this vehicle. And the 8L90 being torque management based, it basically shifts off the torque applied to it rather than predetermined lookup tables. The LT4 does add one more variable in the shifting strategy, I find. The LT motors, the LT1s, the L86s, L83s, and I want to throw in there that we are going to be supporting the L84 and the L86 in the near future, so look out for that. But these engines don't tend to downshift, especially with the 8 and the 10 speed, like the older LSs and the Hemis, and the reason is the technology again. The ability to phase the cam and get back into the power band without shifting the transmission, the high compression, direct injection, it all comes into play. I noticed with the LT4s that we built, the supercharger will also kick in and keep that transmission from downshifting. So the extra boost from that blower is going to come in at the lower RPM and help move the weight of the vehicle rather than depend on shifting the transmission. A lot of you guys want to buy LT4 kits. Until now, we haven't offered one. Over the last few builds, we're refining the LT4 install in the JK, and we hope to offer it in the JL and the JT. We've got some new brackets, some new air intake components. The LT4 is larger than the LT1. I would say it's not quite as big as the L86, just because of the way it lays out. We're using our Easy Mount. Like everything else GM, these LT4s lend themselves well to modifications. And there's guys getting 700 plus horsepower easily with these engines. You gotta be careful. From what I understand, getting fuel to the engine is one of the critical things. The LT5 went to two sets of injectors. So under boost, you got an extra set of port injectors to help. This vehicle is really heavy. It's got heavy tires, it's got heavy axles. It's got a lot of aerodynamic drag. So this LT4 pulls it with ease. There's not many engines that could pull this kind of weight and this kind of drag, low stressed. I think we should mention here that while the Hemi and the LSs are both aiming for the same goal, and that is horsepower and drivability, I think GM and Chrysler approached it a little bit differently. Chrysler's still using their speed density system, where GM is still using a lot of technology. GM went to direct injection so they could run higher compression. GM went to continuous variable valve timing. Stepping up to the 8-speed transmission was a big bonus for both manufacturers. GM stepped up to a 10-speed transmission now, and yes, we've got a LT4 10-speed coming up soon. GM likes a lot of feedback into their computers. If we look at the airflow meter alone, the MAF sensor, it has a humidity sensor, an air intake temp sensor. We've got a supercharger inlet pressure sensor. We've got a MAP sensor. We've got a MAP sensor, meaning manifold absolute pressure sensor. We've got a barometric pressure sensor. We've just got all this feedback into this computer, and it is a massively complex computer. This computer not only has to deal with all that, but it has to deal with the direct injection, emissions, CVVT. So I think GM took the high road in technology, where Chrysler stayed more true to the traditional hot rod engine, tried to keep it simple, but put enough technology into it to get what they wanted. The higher compression of the LT engines, especially the non-supercharged or the normally aspirated engines, do have the potential of putting out more horsepower with fewer engine mods. I'm still blown away by the fact that this engine is 10 to 1 compression ratio and has 9.7 pounds of boost. If you think about that, that's close to 20 to 1. That's diesel territory in compression. Back in the old days, we did some work with Gale Banks and Airflow Research. We did turbochargers like in the 70s and 80s. And if we had like a 305 Chevy, 350 Chevy, back in that day, they were running 8.8, 9 to 1. We'd put 5, 6, 7 pounds of boost into them. You put much more than that in, you'd scatter the motor. Kind of like what you'd get if you put a blower on a normally aspirated JK V6 engine. And while I'm talking about the past, I'll relive one of our greatest moments. We put a Gale Banks blow-through system on a 305 Chevy van. The blow-through system basically meant that we blew through a carburetor. Remember, we didn't have the fuel injection that we have today. We didn't have the computers we have today. So we put a blow-through on a 305 Chevy engine, and it had a what I called a bonnet. It was basically a cover that went on top of the carburetor. My brother was quite the daredevil. He was actually a champion motocross racer, but when it came to cars, he also had a heavy right foot. So he got into it, the wastegate stuck. We went from about 10, 11 pounds of boost to gauge hit over 20 PSI, and he kept his foot into it. And I gotta say that little 305 put out a lot of horsepower for just a little while. The bonnet blew off the carburetor, came right through the engine cover and into the windshield. Those were the days when we got horsepower through crude technology. It wasn't anything like today. If you look at this LT4, it's just amazing how much feedback. You got input sensors like oxygen sensors, MAP sensors. Then you got output devices like fuel injectors and solenoids. The more information you put into that computer, the better results you can have out. So I think Chrysler took the minimalist approach on the Hemi. For decades, the Dodge brothers and Chrysler really were the pioneers of technology in their day. And I think we have to look at Chrysler today. It's almost two separate companies. If you look at the Fiat side of it, where everything is small and light and high technology, and then you look at the Hemi, which is really a brute of an engine, there's a dichotomy there. I've heard rumors that Chrysler might drop the Hemi, but I also heard rumors that Chrysler might drop the full-frame JK and not go to the JL. They were going to go to some unibody thing. But I think the demand of Americans to have a body-on-frame with live axles was this making Chrysler way too much money. And it proved true. When they released the JL and now the JT, they're selling a lot of them. Could you imagine if they had come out with something like that little Liberty or Comanche or whatever that thing was and tried to make that into the Wrangler, put a little high-tech turbocharged four-cylinder in it? I don't think that would have went over really well with a lot of Americans. So the brute force side of Chrysler having the Hemi is really becoming somewhat of the red-headed stepchild. However, Chrysler does have a lot of high-tech vehicles that I think make a lot of sense. We really like our Pacifica with a 9-speed and the Pentastar engine. The 9-speed does have some timers where it doesn't know what gear to go in, but all the manufacturers had issues with that early on. I think the 10-speed, the 10L80, is probably the best launched high gear transmission in recent years. We've installed several with zero issues, zero tuning. They work right out of the box. Now, if we look at GM, I think GM have always been a performance company. I think they've always been about engine performance. Yeah, there were the dark days in the 70s and the 80s, but if you look at the 50s, 60s, 70s, GM and Ford got into the horsepower race. Chrysler got into it too. The Hemis dominated drag racing. But as you look at the 80s, 90s, GM really stayed true to their performance division. If you look at the IROC Camaros, the SS Camaros in the dark days, they were a little bit of hope. Chrysler did go back down to the little four-cylinder K cars with turbos, and they had some weird performance Shelbys and things. But GM really stayed true to the V8. Even Ford had some dark days with a little compact Mustang II and the following Mustang. The SVOs with little four-cylinder turbos. GM always seemed to be true to the overhead valve V8 that they pioneered back in the mid-50s. And that's kind of what we're driving right now, a modern small block with a blower on it. And I'll try to make this quick because we're going to be doing some more test drives in this vehicle. So GM took that overhead valve V8 from about 70 years ago, and they just kept updating it and updating it. We had the Gen 1 small block, the Gen 2, the Gen 3, the Gen 4, and now we got the Gen 5. And when you say the Gen 5 LT doesn't have a whole lot in common with its distant cousin, it really does. It is a two-valve, overhead valve, 90-degree V8 with very similar architecture. And while some of the Europeans and Asians might laugh at the technology in these engines being based in 50, 60, 70-year-old technology, the reality is GM has added technologies that not only make them compete, but beat a lot of the competition. An 11.5-to-1 compression V8 engine with direct injection is nothing to sneeze at. And I think the Corvette has proven that you can build Ferrari-level performance in a vehicle that costs a third or a quarter of the price. So we're just gonna do a little bit of off-roading in this LT today, gather some information, and we'll be back soon with a lot more test drives, including another test drive on this vehicle.